At first, there were a few thousand families driven by a dream. The dream of a prosperous, educated, caring community steeped in Jewish values. The dream was called Jewish Toronto. And as the community grew through waves of immigration, the dream remained. It consoled and strengthened us during the darkest days. It inspired us as bad times turned around. It pushed us into bold new decisions, into uncharted territory. Today, for nearly 200,000 members of our community, that dream is Jewish Toronto Tomorrow. Jewish Toronto Tomorrow is unprecedented. It's a response to new needs caused by a growing, moving, maturing community. It's the largest development program in our community's history. It will build three campuses for Jewish life in the south, central, and northern reaches of the Greater Toronto Area. It will create new community partnerships. It's a chance for everyone to get involved. But the journey to Jewish Toronto Tomorrow does not begin here and now. It began decades ago on the crowded downtown streets of a very young city.
I'm Irving Abella, and I thought we'd begin this historical journey of Jewish Toronto, where I was born. We are at Spadina and Queen. Between 1919 and 1950, this was the heart of the Jewish working class area. This is the area of four or five blocks around here where 70% of Toronto's Jews worked in the factories and lofts of the shmata business. Every morning, about beginning at 5, there would be an army of Jewish workers heading down the streets to walking because it was too expensive to use a streetcar, heading to their jobs. And sometimes they'd stop here at this little store behind me, which was called Abella's Lunch. I lived upstairs. And they would have breakfast and perhaps a coffee. And often the politicians of the area, the major ones, David Kroll and Joe Salzberg, would come in and hold meetings with their constituents, and I would serve them coffee and donuts, and the only tips I got were political ones.
When people come together, you know, food is always a central part of coming together, and a lot of discussion happens over meals. And as I said, it was a place where new immigrants to the country could come and meet up with friends and families that had moved into Canada already. We had a lot of very influential people that came into the restaurant. People from the trade unions, Max Fetterman, Nachum Shemin, all the Congress people. And a lot of very, very important decisions were made at United Bakers.
The Minsker Shul, just like the Kiever Shul a few blocks from here, was one of the many dozens founded by the generation of immigrant Jews who arrived here in the first three decades of the 20th century. They were concerned about the survival of their religious life, and so created these small synagogues, or shtiblech, which were in every detail Eastern European transplant. It's important to remember that this wasn't simply a prayer hall. It was a community center, it was a religious institution, it was a cultural center, it was a school. It's where the neighborhoods got together and talked and argued and discussed who to bring over from the old country. And it was very important in the neighborhood for bringing boys and girls together, because outside of these shtiblech, outside of these schools, the boys in the congregation would flirt with the neighborhood girls.
This is Holy Blossom Temple, which is the senior synagogue of the Jewish community of Toronto, founded in 1856. This building was planned in a very progressive manner. First of all, it was farther north than one would have expected a congregation to move in that period, and that was probably due to the influence of a number of affluent and powerful members in the congregation who were already living in Forest Hill. The synagogue was built far larger than was necessary for the needs of the congregation in that period, with the expectation that other people would move close by, and that ultimately the sanctuary would be filled, and that expectation did come to reality.
Along with religion, education was of greatest concern to the community two or three generations ago. They were divided about the schools. Should they be Hebrew? Should they be English? Should they be secular? Should they be Orthodox? Should they be Zionist? Should they be anti-Zionist? In the end, everybody won, and we had 10 or 11 schools within a four or five block area of where I am now. This school behind me, it was a school behind the fence, was the Brunswick Avenue Talmud Torah, which eventually moved up to Bathurst and Neptune and became the Associated. And right next to it was the YMHA with its basketball court and swimming pool, which eventually moved to Bloor and Spadina, and it's still there.
The whole downtown area of Toronto has historically been the home of most Jews who have lived in Toronto. And it's the core of the whole community from the way I see things. This place is a true community center, not just for the Jewish community, but for everybody in the downtown area. There's outreach programs here for underprivileged kids who rub shoulders with the richest stockbrokers in town that drive on their way down to Bay Street from Forest Hill. They stop off here in the morning for a workout. Today is a Purim party. Tomorrow could be something else. It's just a great spot to be. And the building has remained the same. So it's crammed to the gills with this vibrancy. And it's now time to pay the building back a little bit for everything it's done for us.
Behind me is the site of what's going to be the Center for Jewish Life at the University of Toronto. It's our hope that this center will breed in the Jewish students that come to this university a sense of pride and give them a place to congregate and to become involved, not specifically with the Jewish community, but to understand that being involved in the community is important.
The Bathurst Jewish Center that we Torontonians knew affectionately as the North Y opened in the early 1960s when Bathurst Street north of Shepherd was simply a dirt road that dipped down into the valley of the West Don River. And it's an example of how the Jewish community has established itself in North York, and the realization that what was then the new Y, that is at Bloor and Spadina, was no longer the center of the Jewish community.
The Jewish institutions we have in this community today were developed many years ago, and they serve the needs of those communities. They no longer serve the needs of our community today, and they certainly won't serve the needs of our community in the future. So if we have any wish or hope for our institutions to be relevant and to be meaningful, we have to change them, upgrade them. They just no longer serve the needs of what we have now, and certainly not the needs of whatever we're dreaming about.
Jewish Toronto Tomorrow has been absolutely instrumental in enabling CHAT to grow. We have grown over 50% in the last 2 years. We are now the largest Jewish high school on the North American continent, and that has been made possible by Jewish Toronto Tomorrow. We could not have done it by ourselves, and as an exercise in community partnership, I think we are the envy of other schools in North America. We are looking at the further expansion of the school. We have been asking for 30 years for a situation where Mr. and Mrs. Average Jewish Family will want to send their kid to a Jewish high school, and we see that, if not happening, we're pretty close to it.
This place will be the most important facility in the Jewish community and in the Jewish world of Greater Toronto. I see the Jewish Community Center, the Atrium Mall, the elementary and high schools, the recreational centers that we're going to have here, the day camps and the summer camps will be a phenomenal place for all of our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren to meet, and will be probably the center of Toronto in the next 25 years. It is only about 3 minutes from Highway 7, maybe 6 minutes from Steeles Avenue. It is a phenomenal location. I think we are very blessed to have this jewel in our crown of Jewish Toronto Tomorrow.
There's so many new challenges. UJA Federation alone can't handle the whole thing. I mean, we have an important role to play, but in order to get the job done, in order to get all this huge agenda covered, we have to engage with so many different new partners. We have to create strategic partnerships with so many other players in order to accomplish this task. It's too big for one organization, and it can only be accomplished if we all work and pull together.
Our dream is to see in the partnership model an enhancement of the breadth, depth, and quality of services which we can deliver. We're in the healthcare delivery business. Other people, parts of the committee, are in the social services business, and we're also in that.
And we looked at, to see that the partnership will enhance the quality of care, the kindness which we can deliver to all of the Jewish community.
As a community, we have a responsibility not only to ensure that today's needs are met, but to look ahead to the future and ensure that the community will be able to meet the needs of tomorrow. And in the past, and even today, we're doing a good job of meeting the current demands, the current needs through the annual campaign. But today, when we look ahead, we see unprecedented changes coming. And we can see that unless we do something really big time today to anticipate and plan for those needs won't be met.
When we first started off with Jewish Toronto Tomorrow, we were presented with the case of the growth and the changing demographics. And one of the statistics that were thrown out around the table was that you had a 75% chance of living in the same community as your children right here in Toronto. I stopped for a moment and I said, wait a minute, this is an amazing community. I'm from Winnipeg and everybody moves out of Winnipeg. And in Toronto, what a wonderful, wonderful thing to be able to have happen is that as you age, your children and their children are going to be here in the community. And I said to myself, what could be better?
Jewish Toronto Tomorrow is our past, present, and future. It is a way for us to treasure our traditions, respond to dramatic change, and confidently face the years to come. The dream and the dreams.